So in this next lesson, we look at section 5.2 of module 5 or lesson 5, and we talk about STP operations. Now there are at least three main objectives of this part of the lesson. At least we are able to observe the port roles, the different port roles. We look at the port states, we observe the parts, talk about operational details of each port state. Now, this is where I move on to section 5.2. So when you're watching this video, I would suggest you download the lecture notes and go to section 5.2 and then you follow along. Details are in that lesson. Okay, so I will be making reference back to the lecture notes from time to time as we cover this part of the lesson 5. Okay, so the main objective here or key thing that we're trying to understand is how does STP work? How does STP operate? Now, in the last video, I did mention that spanning tree protocol gives us an algorithm. Okay, the spanning tree algorithm. Now, this spanning tree algorithm has four basic steps that it uses to build a loop-free topology. Now, the steps are straightforward. So for the rest of this video, I'm going to cover each one of these steps. The first step is electing a root bridge. That's the first thing the STP will do. It will have to first of all elect a root bridge. Okay, so that's the first thing a switch will need to do. STP will need to do. After it elects the root bridge, it then moves on to electing the root ports. Okay, it elects the root ports. Step number three, elects the designated ports, and then finally it elects alternate ports that are usually in a block state. Okay, so we're going to be looking at each of these steps. How does the STP elect the root bridge? What parameters does it use to build the root bridge? And what gets to determine who gets to be the root bridge? And then what are the root ports? What's their purpose? What do they do? What are the designated ports? What are the alternate ports? What's their purpose? Okay, so we look at each one of these sections as we go through in this lesson. Now, one of the things you will have to note here is that during the spanning tree algorithm and STP functions, switches exchange messages or information about themselves and their connection, and they use what's called BPDUs. Okay, they use BPDUs, BPDU messages, BPDUs, bridge protocol data units. Okay, bridge protocol data units. So they use these BPDU messages to exchange information about each other, between each other. So if you look at this network here, we have switch 1, switch 2, switch 3, switch 4, 5, and 6. What I suggest you do before we continue further is you can pause the video, go to switch 1, and change the host name to SW1 if it's not SW1. Okay, so I think I've done that for all 6 switches. So SW1, this one is SW2, and so on. Okay, so no basic configurations, I just gave the host name. Okay, so you can pause the video, give the names, give host names for all 6 switches before we can continue on. The next thing we need to understand about BPDUs is that this bridge protocol data units, or the BPDU messages, are important because switches, STP actually uses this information to select a root bridge. Okay, that's the first thing. Switches use the BPDU messages that they share among themselves and their connections to elect a root bridge, and then they use that same information to elect root ports, designated ports, and eventually alternate ports. So each BPDU contains certain things. It contains a bridge ID, okay? It contains a bridge ID, and that bridge ID is made up of 3 types of information. Okay, so every bridge, when we use the word bridge, we are really referring to the switches. Okay, so the bridge ID is made up of 3 key information: the bridge priority, extended system ID, which is referring to the VLAN ID, and then the MAC address. Okay, So the BID is very important. The bridge ID is involved in making many of the ST editions, including who gets to be the root bridge and what port roles they will play. So the BID contains the priority value, bridge priority, the MAC address of the switch, and the extended system ID or the VLAN ID. Now, one key thing you need to take note of here is who gets to be elected as the root bridge. The root bridge, who gets to be elected as the root bridge? It is the lowest switch with the lowest BID value becomes the root bridge. Okay, that's the key determining factor. Who gets to be elected as the root bridge? The lowest BID value. So the lowest BID value again is determined by a combination of these three fields: the bridge priority, the extended system ID, and the MAC address. Now I'd like you to do something here. You will see that there are several show commands you can use with spanning tree. Show spanning tree active is one of the first commands we will use. So you go to switch one and you type in the privilege exec mode, show spanning tree active. Okay, so when you type show spanning tree active, you will see that there are two sets of information given by this output. You have the root ID, okay, which tells us who is the root bridge. Okay. For now, we want to know what's the ID, what's the BID of this particular switch, switch 1. And this is the information you need, bridge ID. Okay, so you can see priority is 32769, which is actually 32768, but you add the extended system ID of 1, which gives you a priority of 32768 plus 1, and you end up with 32769. Now, you can note that information down for all six switches. Again, you can pause the video, do a show spanning tree active on switch 1, switch 2, switch 3, switch 4, 5, and 6. You will notice that for all six switches, they will have the same bridge priority, 32769. Okay, so you don't need to do that for all six switches. Okay, so I've done that here for just switch 1 only. Because they all have the same bridge priority, I'm just putting that up here. However, what we need to note down is the MAC address. Okay, so note the MAC address for switch 1, go to switch 2, copy the MAC address again. You can observe the bridge priority, you will notice it's still the same, 32768 plus the extended system ID 1. Why it's 1? Because the default VLAN is VLAN 1. So VLAN 1 plus 32768 gives us 32769, which is what you see up here. Okay, so we won't write down the bridge ID priority. Okay, let's just make a note here that all switches have the same priority value. Okay, they all have the same priority value, so we do not need to note that down. However, we do need to note down the MAC address of each switch. So again, what you should do here is pause the video, go ahead, do a show spanning tree active, copy paste all the MAC addresses against next to each switch, and then we can continue. Okay, so by now you would have copied all the MAC addresses for each switch and then placed it next to the switch. Now, when you do a show spanning tree active, you will notice you get a lot of information apart from just the root ID and bridge ID. You also get to see information about the hello timing, the maximum age, the forward delay, the age time. These are all defaults. Okay, you'll find the default values the same across all the switches. So again, you don't need to note that down. Okay, the default values, hello timer is 2 seconds. What does that mean? Every 2 seconds, a BPDU message is sent across. Okay, that's the interval for every BPDU message every switch exchanges. Okay, 2 seconds. Maximum age, 20 seconds. Forward delay, 15 seconds. Aging time, 20 seconds. So these are default values for STP to use, and they are the same across all three switches. And the bridge priority is also the same across all switches. So what we need to note down is the MAC address. And by the way, when you were doing this, did you notice that one of the switches in fact has this, and it's switch 4. Okay, and if you go ahead and you type show span tree active across all the switches, you won't see this until you get to switch 4. So this tells us that this bridge is the root bridge. Now we can confirm that by looking at the MAC address of this particular switch. See, the end address is 794E. If you look at the root ID, you can see the address is 794E, which is actually pointing to switch 4 itself. So we'll just note that down here. Okay, that's the root bridge. Okay, that's the root bridge STP has elected. Okay, now we'll come to know why. Why is switch number 4 the root bridge? But for now, if you go to switch 1 and you look at the root ID, you notice that root ID section is telling us who is the root bridge. You see? And where did this information come from? BPDU. Okay, they exchange BPDU and they are able to know what information they share with each other. Okay, so all the switches know who is the root bridge. Okay, they know that. And the MAC address tells us that. The 794E is actually the MAC address shown for switch number 4. Okay, so first question, how did they elect the root bridge? By exchanging BPDU messages. What determine who to become the root bridge? The bridge ID. What values make up the bridge ID? Three things: bridge ID, bridge priority, extended system ID, MAC address. But then we realized that all the switches have the same bridge priority. Okay, all switches have the same bridge priority, which is the default priority value. Okay, the value ranges from 0 up to 61,440, but it increments by 4,096. So the default value is 32768. You add that to the extended system ID, which is the identifying the VLAN for the BPDU, VLAN 1, add that, you end up with 32769. Which is the same across all switches. Since all six switches have the same bridge priority, they have the same extended system ID, what was used to determine the who gets to be the root bridge? Okay, it comes down to one single key factor, and that is the MAC address. Okay, remember, root bridge, lowest BID value becomes the root bridge. Okay, so bridge ID value, since these two are the same, now it's up to the MAC address. Okay, it's entirely up to the MAC address now. So when you look at the MAC address, if you compare switch 1, switch 2, switch 3, 4, 5, and 6, you will see the lowest MAC address is actually switch number 4. Switch number 4 has the lowest MAC address. Okay, switch number 4 has the lowest MAC address. Again, you can start off by looking at the first hex step, the 00D0. This is higher, 6 is higher, D0 is higher, 1 is the lowest. Now, there are two that have 1, switch 4 and switch 5. So when you look at the next one, this begins with 6495, this begins with 42. So switch 4 is the lowest, and switch 4 becomes the root bridge. Okay? First thing, switch 4 becomes the root bridge. Okay, so how did it become the root bridge? You should know what key factors have been used to determine who gets to be the root bridge. The second thing we need to look at is electing the root ports. Okay, the root ports, the designated ports, the alternate ports, we need to look at those things. Okay, so several things we need to look for: the type of port, the port role, and the state it is in. So we'll begin again on switch 1. Okay, so when you click on switch 1, you've already typed show spanning tree active. Okay, so you would have some information down here. Okay, that's the information we need. So you can see port 2, port 1, and port 4. You'll see the roles these ports are in. You'll see the status. Okay, the state that port is in. Now, just one key thing you need to take note of. Anytime a port has a role alternate, it will be in a block state. Anytime a port has a role of root, it will be in a forward state. Okay, that's first thing. So let's just note that down here. Anytime a port has a role of a root port, its state is in forwarding. Anytime it is in alternate, it's in a block state. Now there are times when you will notice that the switch is in a designated mode. Okay, see, if I go to switch number 4, you'll see port 1, port 4, port 2, they're in designated mode. Now notice the status is also forwarding. Okay, so two states that are in forwarding mode is root and designated. Okay, so we'll just put designated here. It's in forwarding state. Okay, so these are key information you need to note down as we go through this lesson. Okay, so several things you will observe here. When you look at port 1, you look at port 4, you look at port 2, you will already see that port 2 and port 4 are already in alternate mode. Okay, they are in alternate role and they are block state because of the orange. Okay, when you look at port 1, port 1 is a root port. Okay, it's in a forwarding state. That's why the interface LED status shows green. Okay, again, you can verify that through the use of show spanning tree active. Show spanning tree active, you can confirm that. You see, port 1 is a root port. It's in a forwarding state. Its cost is 19, the default cost for all Ethernet ports. When you look at port 2, port 4, both ports are in a block state, okay, because they are alternate ports. So I'll just put A for alternate, and we'll put R for root port, and we'll put D for designated port. Okay, so this is a root port, that's an alternate port, that's an alternate port, this is a designated port. Another thing you should observe, every time you have a root port, all the ports on a root port are all designated ports. Okay, you see, you observe that here. See, that's the root bridge. Switch 4 is the root bridge. So all its interfaces are all designated interfaces. You will never find a root port or an alternate port on a root bridge. You'll always find that a root bridge has designated ports. Any interface that points to the root bridge is a root port. So you see, F01 is a root port. It's pointing to switch 4. You'll also see that in switch 5 port number 4 is also a designated interface number 4 role is, however, not a root port but a designated port. I'll explain as we go through why this what's the meaning of these states. The port roles. Okay, so show span again active. So this port 4 is, I'll just pause this. What I suggest you do is pause the video and then you highlight all the port roles. Okay, so for example, port 4 is designated, so I'll put D. So port 4 is D, port 1 is D, port 2 is R, port 3 is D, port 5 is D. So do that for all the switches, the interfaces, every single interface. Just label the interface with either R, D or A, and then we'll continue on to the next part and I'll explain what's the meaning of this root port and designated port and alternate port. We'll look at the next concept using this. So I'll pause the video. You can pause the video, label all the interfaces, and we'll proceed on to the next part. Okay, so assuming you have noted down all the labels for each of the interfaces, do not worry about the interfaces 10, 11, 10, 11 that are connected to the end devices. They don't participate in this STP process, and this is where we can block the BPDU. We can allow for port security here. We can disable them to participate in the STP. Only these interfaces need to participate. Okay, so I'll explain why we had to label all of that, all of those interfaces with the root port as a root port, designated port, alternate port. One of the things you have to take note about the root bridge is that, remember, the root bridge is elected for a specific reason. The root bridge will be used as a reference point to which all of the switches will determine the root path cost. Okay. They will determine the best possible path by using the root bridge as their reference point. Okay, so when you look at the topology here, we are going to trace the root ports. Remember I mentioned earlier on that the root bridge always has all its interfaces as designated, and anytime you have a switch that's connecting to a root bridge, its interface is in a role known as root port. Okay, so I'll draw this so you can see. For instance, switch 3, if PC0 wanted to communicate with PC1, it can send packets frames directly across to switch 6. It can do that. Okay, there's a link there. It can of course send them down up this way and then down. That's another path. Or it could go this way. It could go this way and then down. Okay, that's another possible path. Another path would be it could go up this way, across, and then down. It can even go up, down. You see, there are multiple paths there. You see, this is what redundancy is all about. But what the spanning tree protocol does here is very interesting. It blocks off some of these paths and determines the best possible path to take, which is basically based on the least cost. Okay, the least cost. Now, remember when we went ahead to type switch show spanning tree active, we did observe the cost of each of these interfaces. Okay, the default cost is 19. If you look at slide number 19 of your lecture notes, you will find that for 100 Mbps Ethernet ports, the default cost is 19. Now, interestingly, observe something here. The higher the link speed, the lower the cost. Okay, you see 10 gigabits per second, cost is 2. 1 gigabit, 4. 100 MB, 19. When you go up to 10 Mbps, it's 100. If you go up to the serial links, which are 24 megs, 1.25 megs, 2.4, 5 megs, you start having very high cost. So it's an inverse relationship here. Higher the link speed, lower the cost. Lower the link speed, higher the cost. So the bottom line is, lower cost is more preferable. Okay, lower cost is more preferable, and that will be elected as the, or selected as the best least cost path. Okay, so back to the point of what's the purpose of the root port, alternate port, designated port. Okay, coming back to switch 3. Instead of taking this path to this path, switch 3 will follow, you see the root port, it will follow this. It will go from here to switch 3 will go from here to switch 5, and then the next part it will take is up across. Okay, you see, up this way. If it's going to go to this network, this part of the network, if it's going to go down from here, it will go here. You see, so that's the best part it will take if it's trying to communicate somewhere here with devices up here or here. If it's going to communicate with devices down here, it will go this way, this way. Notice it's going from root to the switch and then to another root. You see, root to destination, to designated, and then from that switch to another root. You see, from here it went designated and then followed the root port up to designated port again. These are the least cost path it will take. So from here to get to this switch, it can either go this way, but it's not going to go because this port is blocked. Okay, it may go this way, but this port is blocked. Okay, so it's going to go this way. Now from here, it can either go this way or this way, but again, notice this port is blocked. This is blocked, so it's not going to take this path. It will go up. If it's going to go down, it will go this way. Okay, it's not going to go back the same way it came from. Okay, so you see what's happening here. The least cost path is now being selected. Okay, remember, it elects a root bridge, it elects the root ports, elects the designated ports, elects the alternate ports. Why does it have to do all of this? Because those spots determine what's the least cost part it will use. Okay, this is also known as the root part cost. Okay, so it will elect the root ports, alternate ports, designated ports, because it wants to find out what's the root part cost. Once it finds the root part cost to all other networks, all other devices, then it will calculate what's the least cost part. Okay, the least cost part is simply the part with the lowest cost. Okay, that's basically what it means, part with lowest cost. Okay, so it's like if you're going to go from destination A to B, you have alternative options to take. You can either go by air, go by ship, or go by land, but you make your decision based on several factors like the cost, the safety, the ease of transport that you're going to use. Those are factors. In this case, in STP uses the cost of each interface it's going to travel by. Okay, so these are all 100 MB Ethernet interfaces. The default cost is 19. Okay, so it will use that root part cost, find all the root part cost, and then select the least cost part. Okay, again, it's using the root bridge as a reference point. So you notice they're all pointing up to the root bridge. Now, if we go to switch one, again, when you look at switch one can either come down this way, but it's not going to go because it's blocked. It won't come here. It won't come here because it's blocked. It's going to go across to from root to designated, you see? And then if it's going to go to the other networks down here, it will go from here across this way. You see, notice it's not going to go down. It can either go this way or go down, okay? It will go down this way. Now, it's not going to come back. Notice this interface is blocked. It won't go across, this interface is blocked. So it can go directly down. So for PC0 to get to PC1, it will go this way, across, and then down. Okay. For laptop to go to PC1, it will follow that. If there was a device connected to switch 1, it would follow that path, come down this way. And then notice once it comes this way, it has no way to go because these are all blocked. These interfaces are all blocked. So it will need to go across, direct down to any device here. Okay. If it's trying to communicate with the device here, it will go across, down this way. You see? So I hope you pick up the key point there. The whole idea is it blocks certain parts so that allows only specific interfaces to be open, and these interfaces are the least cost part. Okay, so four main steps that we were able to observe here. I'd like to draw your attention back to the key one, which is electing the root bridge. Okay, it elects the root bridge based on identifying what's the bridge ID, and the bridge ID is made up of three key things: bridge priority value, extended system ID, and MAC address. Okay, given that all the switches have a default bridge priority, it's the same, they have the same extended system ID, it now uses the MAC address, and the lowest MAC address gets to be elected as the root bridge. Okay, after the root bridge is elected, it now has to determine or elect the root ports, designated ports, alternate ports, or block ports. Now remember that root ports will forward packets. Alternate ports, they will be blocked. Designated ports, they will also forward packets. So forward frames. So these are the two we are interested in, root and designated. The root and the designated indicate to you what part is going to be used. Okay, the possible parts that will be used, or the least cost part that will be used. So the least cost part is from the root to the designated, or designated to root. Okay, it doesn't go to alternate, because alternate, remember, it's in a block state. It will never forward any frames. Okay, it will never forward frames. But anytime any of these links go down, what happens? Okay, again, STA has to, the spanning tree algorithm has to recalculate during link failure, and then some of those block pots might be turned on again to recalculate what's the least cost path. So that's the whole idea here. If you were to assign 16, 16, 16, you will find out what this cost is. So for example, to get from PC0 to PC1, frames will go from here. Okay, frames will go from here across. So this is 16. Okay, that cost is 16. And then they will go down. That's another 16. So what's the root cost, root path cost? 16 plus 16. Okay, that's the total or cumulative cost. To get from here to here to a different location, again, you have to STPS to calculate all that. So that's the whole idea behind why switches or spanning tree algorithm has to elect the root port, it has to elect the designated port, it has to elect the alternate port, because that information helps it to determine what's the root path cost, and based on the root path cost, it will now find out what's the least cost path. And the least cost path determines where frames will be forwarded when a PC is trying to communicate with others in the same network. Okay, so in the event that the bridge priority is different and the extended system ID is different, then all these three factors put together and the lowest BID becomes the root bridge. What you have seen here is because these values are the same, it now uses the MAC address. But priority is always bridge. The key value it will always look at is the bridge priority. Now, there are cases where bridge priority is, let's say, what if we didn't change the bridge priority and extended system ID, we left it as the same. Okay, it used the MAC address to determine who gets to be the root bridge. What happens if I go to switch 2 and change the bridge priority to 0? Now, anytime a bridge priority value is set to 0, that priority value takes precedence over the lowest MAC address. Okay, so again, do note that. Okay, the default port priority value is 128. Okay, it's 128, but by the time you set this priority value to a different value, and if you set it to 0, once you set it to 0, it takes precedence over all the other information. Okay, so that means STA has to recalculate again using that value, and most likely this will become the root bridge because it has the lowest bridge priority compared to the others. Okay, so these three things are inseparable. They're used together to determine what's the bridge ID, and the BID, lowest BID value, becomes the root bridge. In the event that one of these values is the same across all devices, the others are used. Okay, so I think that's the key point to take note of here. The second thing, let me just explain the values, the default values here. Okay, so you know hello timer is 2 seconds. That's the interval between every bridge protocol data unit. So every 2 seconds, switches exchange BPDUs. Okay, 2 seconds. Can be modified between 1 to 10 seconds. Okay, but the default is 2. The purpose of the forward delay is the time that is spent in the listening and learning state. Okay, so remember, ports can be either in an alternate port, it can be either a root port or a designated port. If it's a root port or a designated port, they are forwarding frames. If they are alternate ports, remember, alternate ports, they are not forwarding anything. However, they are listening, okay? They are waiting, listening. And if one of these root or designated interfaces or links go down, the alternate port will now change after recalculation from an alternate block state, okay, to a listening state to now forwarding state. Okay, so take note of that. So the forward delay is the time that is spent for the list from in the listening and learning state. So default is 15 seconds, and again can be modified to between 40 to 30 seconds. But the port will take 15 seconds to go from listening to forwarding. The next one, the max age timer, that's the maximum length of time that the switch waits before attempting to change the STP topology. So The default here is 20 seconds, so it waits every 20 seconds before it tries to change the STP topology. So do note that the default times can be changed on the root bridge. Okay, they can be changed on the root bridge, which then dictates the value of these timers for the whole entire STP domain. So you don't need to change it on all the other switches. You just need to change it on the root bridge, and that root bridge will dictate everything else that happens in that particular domain. So when we get to start the video on PVSD Plus, I will explain when you have multiple VLANs. This is where you will now have more than one domain. Okay, so you will have STP per VLAN. You see, at this stage, we are all in the same, well, all these devices are all in the same VLAN, the default VLAN, VLAN 1. So they are all part of one single STP domain, and the root bridge is their leader. So root bridge makes the calls, the rest of the switches, they follow. Okay, so hello timer, forward delay timer, max age timer, you can change that at the root bridge, and the root bridge will dictate what happens in the rest of the devices in that domain. So again, another key thing you need to note here, ports can go from blocking state to listening state, okay, to learning state, to forwarding. Anytime there is a change in the status of the interfaces, if a link fails, STP will recalculate, and then an interface will go from block, it will transit into listening, transit into learning, and eventually into forwarding. So notice when it's in a block state, it's in alternate, it's an alternate port, okay, role is alternate. When it goes into listening, learning, it moves from alternate eventually into a root port or a designated port. Okay. It can now start forwarding traffic. Okay, so that's the operational details of each port. If you go to slide 29, you should be able to see that. The table shows you the port states, the BPDUs, the MAC address table, what happens, and the forwarding data frames. So you see, again, block state, they don't forward frames. When it's listening, it does not forward frames. When it's learning, neither does it forward frames. And it's forwarding state, yes, it does forward frames. Disabled state, no, it does not forward any frames. So the only time, the only role that a port can be able to forward frames is when it's in a forwarding state. Okay, if it's learning or listening, or it's block state, it's not able to forward frames. Okay, so when we get to different VLANs, we'll start to realize that you can create different instances of STP. Here we are creating only, we created only one single instance of STP because they are all in the same VLAN. When you get to pair VLAN spanning tree, that's when you start to create multiple instances of spanning tree protocol, and you can now decide to create different root bridges, one root bridge for VLAN 20, one root bridge for VLAN 10, one for VLAN 30, and so on. See, you can create different root bridges based on the VLAN itself. Okay, so I think this lesson is mainly for me to explain STP operation. So again, let me just summarize the key things. Using spanning tree algorithm, STP builds a loop-free topology in four steps. Okay, and these steps are outlined here: electing a root bridge, electing the root ports, electing the designated ports, and then electing the alternate ports. So first point, how does it elect the root bridge? We have to know that it uses the bridge ID. First of all, switches exchange BPDUs. In the BPDUs, you find information about the bridge ID. And the bridge ID contains three key values: bridge priority, extended system ID, and MAC address. This information is used by the switch to determine who gets to be elected as the root bridge. So what factor is used to elect who gets to be the root bridge? The lowest bridge ID value becomes the root bridge. After they select the root bridge, now it's the turn to elect the root ports, alternate ports, and designated ports. And these ports are elected basically because of one key thing. It's to find out what's the root path cost between all the switches. Once STP is able to take the root path cost of all the switches, it calculates what's the least cost path with the lowest cost. Once it determines that, then it puts those interfaces that are higher cost into block states. Okay, and then it puts some interfaces into root and designated. So notice that traffic or frames follow the root to designated, designated, root to designated, root to designated. They follow those paths. They don't follow the paths that are designated to alternate. No. Okay, that's the whole idea why switches spanning tree have to elect the root bridge, alternate port, and the designated port. Another thing we should observe here is we can modify bridge priority on a root bridge. And when we modify the bridge priority on a root bridge from the default 128, if we set it to 0, the 0 takes precedence. So anytime there's a recalculation, 0 will be the preferred bridge priority, and it will most likely become the root bridge other than any other numbers. In the example we saw here, bridge priority and extended system ID were the same, so it used a MAC address. There are default values that the root bridge can use to determine, to change what happens in the STP domain. The hello timer, the maximum age, the forward delay, and the aging time. Okay, we were able to see that. Another thing you have to observe is to calculate the root path cost, every one of these links has a cost. And the cost is based on the default cost that are assigned to every link speed. And we know that switches Ethernet links are 1000 MB. By default, the 100 Mbps, the default cost is 19. The key thing you have to note here is higher the link speed, lower the cost. Lower the link speed, higher the cost. And ports can go from block state to listening state, learning, and eventually forwarding state. So in the next lesson, that's when I cover PVST Plus. We look at configuring PVST Plus, and we can modify. Okay, just before I conclude this lesson, one of the things you will observe about why we have to look at STP is PVST Plus is that, take for example this network here. You see none of these interfaces is blocked. Okay. None of these interfaces is blocked. All these interfaces are all on. There are instances where we would want, let's say, VLAN 20 traffic to take this path. Okay? We want traffic in VLAN 30 to take this path as the main path. Now, whenever a root bridge is selected, there's always a backup. So VLAN 20, that's your primary path. Your backup path, take this route. Okay? VLAN 30, that's your primary path. Your backup path, take this route. So you see there's redundancy there. There is redundancy there. So when your network is able to withstand any failures within the network. So again, back to the key point, redundancy is the main thing here. We want to ensure that not just physically we allow for redundancy, but logically we also provide redundancy in our network. Okay. That's it. Thank you. Make sure you download that file and follow through in the lab.